I'm Francisco, as you can see. So, who is this guy? So, originally I did physics, but then got sidetracked into IT. And about 10 years ago, a friend of mine said, go to Cisco, they've got funny interviews. And I got a job. So I used to work in the Cisco pack. So that's the, let's say, help desk. So if stuff works, I'm surprised. And also doing the FOSDEM network for the last 10 years now. More recently, I'm doing data science and machine learning. So, what are you using for connectivity? So, logically, actually, it's a reasonably simple setup. You've got a core switch with a central router and then a few switches per location. However, traffic is not so simple. When you actually talk to one of the APs, your traffic goes to one of the APs here in the room, then gets encapsulated, sent to the network of the ULB, where it goes into a wireless LAN controller that basically handles all of your traffic. So if you have a connection to the network and you walk out of this room, the WLC is going to notice that the signal strength is going to go down and that the signal strength from the other IP is going to go up and is going to tell your client to please connect to the other IP. And that will sometimes work. Better like this? Better like this? Better like this?
Yeah.
Okay. So, the WLC handles all your traffic. So what we actually do is we use all the APs of the ULB. So 10 years ago, we would install access points all over the place, but we don't do that anymore. We basically do it just in Janson. You've seen the poles with the APs on top. After the WLC gets the traffic, it gives it back to the router. That then manipulates it and sends it out to the internet at large. So basically, your traffic goes over our network twice, sometimes three times, depending a bit. So everything goes through the router. So that's it during build-up. It's about this high. Costs the better part of a house. So at the bottom, you see the two RPs. We'll come back to that. And above that, the switching fabric, and then basically the SPAS, they call it. Not drinking water, but stuff to take the cards. And above it, you can actually see the core switch. So, main features. ISSU. Who here knows ISSU? Good. Two guys I expected to know. So ISSU, basically, you can upgrade this, and it won't go down. You can actually upgrade it while it's forwarding traffic. Nothing happens. Sorry?
That's
fear. I mean, tech has a lot of problems, and sometimes it even works. It also has non-stop forwarding, which basically is used for ISSU. Basically, you've got two RPs, and one of the two can basically crash, die, and burn, and the other one takes over. It has a ORI, so you can plug new devices in while it's still running. And it's not using iOS. Please don't say iOS for everything. This is iOS XE, which is the new version. High level looks a bit like this. So can I actually move my mouse up to here? And, yeah. So you have the two RPs, which are the route processors. And they basically talk BGP with the rest of the world. And you've got the two ESPs to actually do the forwarding of the traffic, and then you've got the route cards below that basically take care of the cards, so they check, do health checks and stuff. So, the RP, in the past, routers, small CPUs, no, these are two Xeon processors with 16 gigabytes of memory. The memory is there for the BGP table. We see all the networks on the internet. actually at a hard disk, so you can actually log something decent. And that's where you actually log into. On some models, you can actually run service modules, which is called KVM. You might have heard of it. The ESP, that's actually what I always consider SDN. So the forwarding actually is done not in hardware, but there is called a quantum flow processor marketing. That basically is like a big piece of silicon. It contains 256 CPUs that basically handle all the traffic. So that talks to the ERP with an API. So if you're running, for instance, a cloud services router, it's the same architecture, except this is just another process in on your Linux box. And then you've got the SPAS, which are tiny computers, because they basically just take care of the cards. Is the card there? Is it healthy? Stuff like that. So, how do you monitor the traffic, the network actually? I'm going to talk a bit about this. There's a talk of Richard probably tomorrow, and he's going to talk more about how they set up Grafana and stuff. So, we use SNMP. Who knows what SNMP means? Simply not my problem. So, what is it exactly? Well, it's really old. Really old. And you can see it in some of the excellent design choices. So, bit of language. On the router, we have an agent. APs. And the agent can send traps to the management station, like, I just lost an interface. And the management station can get values from the agent, but can also set them, actually. So that's SDN avant la lettre. That's actually what some of our products are. Cisco Prime and stuff, they often use SNMP to set values on devices. So SNMP itself is a bit strange. Basically, it represents everything as a tree. And the path through the tree is the OID. And you can basically say, get me that OID, if you know it, or you can say, walk the tree for me. It uses UDP, so if there's a network problem and you need to send a trap, you use UDP. So it's sure to get lost along the way. So version 1, we trust everybody. Version 2, the students are getting nasty, so let's put clear text authentication in. That didn't work, so it made version 3, which nobody's using in the secure mode because it's the custom certificate authorities. Nobody's using that. So, UID, wonderful, a series of numbers. So for that, you need to translate it into something that a human can use, and that you use a MIB for. The MIB uses ASN1 syntax. So sorry for the flashbacks and painful memories. So it looks a bit like this. Just too horrid to live. So MIPs are extremely messy. On my Debian box, if I install the SNMP MIP package and I download them all and I say I want to have the Cisco ones, and I do get one value from my WRC, that will produce 13,000 lines of errors. It will also take 1.2 seconds, just because it needs to load the MIPs and parse them. So it's incredibly bad. So basically, nobody does this. They all go to the, well, people that are using Cisco devices, go to the object navigator, where you can give in the name, for instance, the IP address type, and you press enter, it will tell you the OID. So this wonderful set of IPs. Ooh. And it will also tell you which MIP it is and what devices support is. You can actually walk that tree then, and you can see what other interesting things are in the neighborhood. So, for example, this is how an walk looks like if you ignore all the error messages. So you get stuff like IF number, but then look at what the rest is. you get a table, where's my words? A table of interfaces with an index and then a number. So index, so interface one is this thing, which is Ethernet, which has an MTU 1500. Now there are two problems with this. One, these numbers by standard can change. If you reload this, the device, it might be something different. Two, it's the wrong order. The device itself doesn't keep track of the of its interfaces in that way. There is one block per interface with all the statistics. It's not a tree. So for one, two interfaces, this is no problem. If you've got a fully loaded Nexus 7000 with 16,000 interfaces, not nice. Anyway, we collect this from all of the switches, the ASR, and thank you, UOB, also from the WRC. So if you see those nice graphs with amount of people that came and left, and then they went on for a drink and got drunk, and now also the sales of t-shirts, for example, that also is in the Grafana, and that comes from this. So as I said, several problems. It's UDP. So it's fire and forget, most often forget. There is no concept of high availability. So companies want high availability, so there's not one management station pulling your device, there are two. And then it turns out that the server team also wants to pull, so there are four. And then the database team also wants to see those numbers, so there are six. And then your device doesn't work anymore because it's only pushing out SNMP data. So it's pull, you don't push, so you have to basically say, when will this counter change? I don't know, has it changed yet? Has it changed yet? It's very verbose, and as I said, it goes across the wrong way. However, let's move on. I'll come back to this later. The other thing is we use is NetFlow. Now, who knows NetFlow? Still a few people. So NetFlow, actually it's called Internet Protocol Flow Information Export, or IPFIX, or FNN, or NetFlow, marketing. So basically with NetFlow, you can basically export information about traffic that passes through the router. And you can filter, you can sample, because you don't want to know everything about every flow if you're on a really big device. And you subscribe to it. This is not what's called legal intercept or a span or something, so we don't copy your data, we just gather information about it. So what can we gather? Traditional tuple, source IP, destination IP, ports, flags, header fields, stuff like that. How much you are talking, I mean packets, bytes. Some quality of service measurements, but if you've got voice over IP, we can basically tell jitter and drops and basically, why was the phone call bad? We can tell you. Also, if you have a BGP, we can tell you the autonomous system for the source or destination or the path or what was the neighbor you were using. And then you can use NBAR. Who knows NBAR? No, still quite a lot of people. NBAR basically is deep packet inspection on a router. And you install protocol packs, and they will tell you what this traffic was, up to some granularity, of course. And then you can use that to either implement quality of service or export it as a NetFlow. So what protocol does it know about? Well, quite a lot. For example, if you go to 4chan, that's a protocol. Porn sites are also protocols, Skype is a protocol, and because it changes all the time, you get these protocol packs with more updates. So per protocol, there are some stuff you can export. So for instance, for SMTP, you can export the sender and the server. For HTTP, host, referrer, URL, we don't care about that. We care about user agents. Because the FOSDEM people always ask us, how many people are here? I don't know. How many people are still using Windows? We don't know. to user agents, we can gather statistics and we can tell you how many Windows users there are, how many Android users, etc. That was interesting because when we implemented the IPv6 only, we didn't know if it was causing a problem or not. But by using the user agents, we could see who was fleeing to force them ancient or legacy, and then we could actually report that actually everything seemed to be working. So, how expensive is this all? Actually, not that much. It's DSP doing it, and it's twiddling its thumbs. So, let's look at this live. So, I'm not... This is one I prepared earlier. And I'm not using SNMP because that's a bit too voluminous. I'm just using the command outputs. It also teaches you the commands. So, how does CPU load? Well, lots of SNMP. That's a bit expected. As you can see, actually, not much is going on this device. Because, remember, it's the ESPs doing all the work. But so you can actually say, tell me, how are the control processors doing? And you see everything. So you've got the two RPs, the route processors, the two ESP forwarding engines, and then all the cards. And everything's healthy and happy. By the way, something look familiar in this output? It
looks like top.
Yeah, it looks like, yeah, that's it. That actually is a traditional load average from a Unix machine. Because guess what they're running? You can also see how much memory is in there. As you can see, route processes a lot, and you can see how much is used and committed in. But everything's healthy. That's good to see. And you can see the CPU usage. Again, here. User system, nice idle IRQ, soft IRQ and IO wait should trigger some memories. And now we can actually also look at the data path, so actually the forwarding itself. So here you can see how many packets per second are getting forwarded and how many bytes per second. This looks impressive until you look at the bottom line, 8%. So, and this is with everything on. So it's tagging all the data, exporting it, and the pipe was pretty full at this moment. Let's keep the TCAM because nobody really cares. If you know what TCAM is, you have my sympathies. So you can actually also check what the statistics are for the NetFlow on the router itself, because it needs to gather all these flows. So for instance, you can say for the IPv4, you can basically see how many flows there are. At this moment, there are almost 14,000 flows going on, and at most there are 18,000. And you get a packet distribution, and how many flows you have per protocol. So still an amazing amount of telnets. Something must be wrong there. And what the fastest and the slowest protocol was. This all gets exported to a collector. And then basically per flow we get a source destination, how many packets, and then the user agent. So how we analyze this? Well, open source support for this is sparse. Especially flexible node flow, most of the dumpers that are out there, they don't handle the extra fields. So, brace yourselves. I wrote a Perl script. The first line is use modern Perl, so I'm good, right? It basically takes the data and dumps it. And then, because this is Perl, I could extended to name all the extra fields. However, this is the old stuff. The future is Yang and telemetry and netconf. That's what you guys know, right? If not, let me tell you what's wrong with SNMP. So it's verbose. If you query it for 10,000 interfaces, it will tell you 0 bytes for errors 10,000 times. Doesn't handle H availability, UDP. You have to pull it every few seconds, and then it walks the tree, which is basically pretty much wrong. So what's the solution? It's telemetry. So with all the buzzwords I said before. So basically, you subscribe to the flow. It uses Google protocol buffers, which basically means that instead of having a 16 kilobyte packet, you have a 200 bytes packet because it actually compresses all the values. And internally, it will collect all this information once and then basically send it to all of your monitoring stations. So if you want 8 copies of the same data, it's okay, we don't care anymore. And actually, we get a lot more metrics and we get them faster. A lot more metrics. The metrics we get, they are described by models. And they're actually on GitHub. So as you can see, for XE16 Polaris, we actually published our models this Christmas. I was very happy because I knew they were coming. And actually, Cisco wants to push this, so there is a whole landing page and a Yang development kit to basically get you started with this. And even blog posts that tell you how to do it. So with this, you could basically fully not only monitor the device, but also configure it using whatever language you want. Lots of people seem to like Python more than Perl, but okay. There is one more thing. I am in tech, so I need to push a bit and our agenda too. Who knows the wonderful Cisco command line analyzer? Yes. These are, yay! So basically what it is, it's a tool, you download it, you either dump show text into it, or you basically tell it to connect to a device and it will run some commands. And basically the commands it will run actually come from TAC, because if you send a 200 megabyte show text to us, we are not going to read it manually. We have some tools for that. And basically, some of the tools we made external, so you don't have to log in. But the data will be analyzed by the same tool that TAC is using, and you'll get a report basically saying these and these and these things are wrong with your device. I even ran it against the FOSDEM infrastructure, and to my surprise, it even found problems still. So nobody's perfect, least of all me. So. Questions? Yes?
What platforms support telemetry?
So, okay, so the question was what platforms support telemetry? All platforms that are not legacy. So iOS, that's legacy. So, but iOS XE, which is running on the router, the next version actually runs on the router, but also on, for instance, wireless LAN controllers, that's the Polaris. iOS XR, which is the provider iOS. So if you've got 16 racks of units and that's one router, you're running iOS XR. It's also supported on there, and it's also supported on NXOS, so the data center switches, and the SAN devices, they're also supporting it now. So basically, everything that's not base iOS.
Can we see the live dashboard for now?
The live...
of the connection?
I can log in.
But you can remove the plug.
I don't need to remove the plug, actually. Wait. Let me first quickly go and mirror the screen then.
Okay.
Hoorah. So, this IP is not a secret. If you do a trace route, that's the one you are going to see. So this is, the SSH key authorization. Also works for NetConf, actually. So I have aliases to see this. So at the moment I wait, healthy show process. It's too small? Okay. Wait. Better?
Yeah.
Okay. So, wait. So, SNMP is still the major cause of problems. Load. And you guys are not trying. It's still only 7% of processing load on the devices.
What is the current bandwidth to go to internet?
So internet is to social interface. No. Best option ever. For 410 megabit per second, and about also 380 back.
And you don't know what was the maximum today?
That's what we're using SNMP for. There is history, but it's not both.
It could be richer. So.
Yeah, no, it's.
The last question, what are the Wi-Fi issue with the classic one, and what do we have to use with FOSDEM ancien or something?
What are the Wi-Fi issues with FOSDEM ancient? What device are you using?
When I try FOSDEM, it does not work. I have to use FOSDEM ancien, the second
Okay. Yes. So FOSDEM is IPv6 only. So it works. But if you go to a site that doesn't have IPv6 addresses, we lie to you. You do, because IPv6 is such a huge address space, we basically have the entire IPv4 address space tucked away somewhere. So if you do a DNS request for a site that's only IPv4, we will lie to you and return IPv6 address which we fabricated. If you then go to that IP, the router knows that that this was a lie, and will convert that IPv6 IP back into an IPv4 IP and send it out on the internet. So we do like NATs, but then IPv6 to IPv4. That works if you're using DNS requests. If you just say, I want to go to 8888, no route.
This is also why I'm happy that I run my local resolver. in the other room before and a little bit here, there also seem to be a lot of packet loss in the Wi-Fi. So that might also be a reason why.
Yeah, it could also be. The Wi-Fi in these rooms, they're so by UOB, and the priority of the UOB is that the professor at his desk has Wi-Fi, and the students is optional. So.
That's the NAT 64 translation that you mentioned.
Yes.
That's being done on the ASR computer.
Okay, so about the NAT 64. So the DNS 64 is run on a server we have, but then a NAT 64 is on the ESR 1000, yes.
And what level of resources of the ESR does that use? Is it done in the ESP?
Okay. So what resources does that use? That basically is fully accelerated in the ESP. So almost no traffic hits the RP at all.
Do you have an idea of what proportion of traffic goes through the NAT 64? How much is transmitted?
How much traffic is the NAT 64? We can see how much is in the use in the pool, but no, it's only connections you can see, not the amount of traffic.
Do you have flow data after the net?
No.
Right, because so, yeah, flow data,
so we only collect flow data on the inside because the outside is just too much junk.
Cool. Yes? Worry about the open source projects which do something similar like split DNS 4, 4 and 6.
Yes, so if there is an open source NAT 64, yes, actually the first implementation ever was on FreeBSD.
I mean the DNS.
And the DNS too, but now it's part of bind. It's an option in bind. You basically define the prefix and then everything's automatic.
Thank you, Peter.